Good morning, everybody. I am Parneet Jaggi from Dr. Bhimrao Ambedkar Government College, Sri Ganganagar. Today we are going to discuss a very important topic, the most influential poet of English literature of the modern world, 20th century, T.S. Eliot. Now, T.S. Eliot needs to be discussed for sure for two reasons. Number one, he is the most dominant voice of the present age, 20th and 21st century. Number two, T.S. Eliot is one author and The Wasteland is one poem that is prescribed in almost all the universities in their courses and curriculum. So now when we talk about T.S. Eliot's Wasteland, we cannot really cover it in 1 hour in one session. We take over a month in the class to cover the entire text and its evaluation. So here we are going to take an overview for the examination purposes and we're going to discuss it very briefly. Now, who is Eliot? Let's know something about him. Thomas Stearns Eliot, born in the United States, studied in Paris, married the famous British ballet dancer Vivian. He had established himself as an important poet by 1917, and 1922 he edited a very important journalistic magazine called The Criterion, which was a landmark in his career. He also became the director of the publisher company Faber & Faber, became a British citizen, and for the next 30 years he was to be the most dominant, the most influential figure in English literature. He received the Nobel Prize and he died in London. Now, what is he known for? What are his famous works? We are just going to talk about his prominent writings. He's known for his poem Proof Rock, his long poem The Wasteland, aerial poems, Ash Wednesday, four quartets, and also his plays like Murder in the Cathedral and Family Reunion. Apart from this, he is also famous for his deviation in literary criticism, where he deviated from the regular kind of literary criticism going on in English literature. Now, what is Eliot's world? How does it differ from the other worlds? Eliot is writing in sharp contrast with the 19th century world, especially the Western world, the European world. The 19th century world was more ordered, more disciplined, meaningful. People were optimistic, stable, had faith in religion, in morality. But when Eliot writes, it is a peculiar characteristic of the 20th century, the post-World War society, which is chaotic, which is pessimistic, which has run out of discipline, out of order. It is marked by loss of faith, loss of moral values, and a confused sense of identity. So now when we study the important poem, The Wasteland, we study it on two main contexts. One is the biographical context and the other is the historical context. Now when we look at his life, meeting Ezra Pound was an important event in his life. He introduced him to several modernistic poets. Then he married Vivian, was an important event of his life. He worked at Lloyd's Bank. And then he had a nervous breakdown and recuperated in Switzerland. Now the historical context seems more important because the World War, the First World War in the years 1914 to 18, led the world in shatters. It laid the battlefields to waste, spiritually scarred soldiers and the people at large, physically weakened populations. There was flus and epidemics and lots of losses of lives. Now, Wasteland is an important text, so for that matter, we have to look into the influences, what all influenced Eliot in writing this classic poem. The two books that play a major role in writing Wasteland are The Golden Bough by Fraser and From Ritual to Romance by Jesse Weston, from whom he has borrowed a large number of his allusions and symbols. Besides, we have Carl Jung philosophy and the Tarot philosophy. Now, what actually is The Wasteland? The poem is fearful. The students are reluctant, are hesitant in reading the poem. Why is that? And the authorities are adamant that this poem has to be in the syllabus and even in the competitive exam. So what is The Wasteland? It is a poem of 433 lines, has 5 sections, portrays the disillusionment of the post-First World War society, talks of the past fertility and the present sterility of the civilization, and the mythical linkages that are delineated in the poem are the most important part. Now, why is it problematic? Why are we facing the problem of complexity? Why are we not able to understand this text in the first go? Why have we go over it again and again? Why do we need reference books? Now, there is a logic to this, that Eliot himself provided notes to the poem. Now, that means they were needed. It was not a simple, regular, traditional kind of a write-up that anybody would read and understand. So why is it problematic? For the following reasons. There is association of ideas. The past and the present, they go simultaneously. At times he's talking of the past, suddenly he comes to the present. At times he talks about the BC, about the 1st century, about the 14th century, suddenly he comes to the modern society. So this poses a problem for the students. Then there is a mythical method. Lots of mythological stories, lots of allusions have been taken from ancient mythology, religion, history to validate his point as to what he is saying about the present condition is true. Then his own subjective experiences have been made universal in this. What he felt, what he saw, the poignant touches that he had inside his mind, the disturbance, he was upset at the condition of the unemployment, the epidemics, the chaos all around after the First World War. He has tried to make it universal. This again poses a problem for the reader. Then the use of juxtaposition. Juxtaposition, we know, is parallel and contrast. He's trying to, again and again, he's trying to make two things parallel and make them associated. Then we have quotations from different languages. If the students have already read the text, they must be aware that it is not just English. Had it been a pure English text, it would not have been a problem. But it has quotations from as many as half a dozen languages like Latin, French, German, Sanskrit. So, then the fragmentation. It's in pieces. It is not joined. It is not like a stream. It is not linked. It is fragmented, broken into pieces, which again gives a problem to the students. Then there is the technique of implication. It is not direct in any way. The Wasteland does not say anything directly that look here, the world is dying. Look here, the world is filthy. Look here, the world is broken. Look here, there is no religion. No. He's giving you stories. He's giving you mythology, he's giving you symbols, he's giving you allusions. You have to get the implied meaning, what you infer from that particular story. Then there is the theory of the objective correlative. Eliot was adamant. Eliot was very, very strict in this one theory that it has to be impersonal. Poetry has to be impersonal, and he kind of advocated objective correlative through the Wasteland, in which it is that emotional response has to be awakened in the reader without being personal. The poet remains objective throughout the poem. And even in this poem, Eliot does not say, I feel, I see. He gets a narrative, he gets a story, he gets a myth. So this is objective correlative. And then there are, of course, repetitions of words, images, and phrases in the text. Now, what is it based on? What are the basic mythological legends that the text is based on? We have Tiresias, the character. We know about Tiresias. He's a linkage. He's a character. He's a common thread. He's a narrator at times. He's an observer at other times. Now, but he is a main character in this, who is used here to object things, to portray things, to indicate things, to say things also. Then we have the stories of the Wasteland of King Oedipus of Thebes. We have Wasteland of Fisher King. We have the biblical Wasteland and, of course, the modern Wasteland. Now, what is the structure of the Wasteland? How many sections do we have? We have 5 sections in the Wasteland. It starts with an epigraph dedicated to Ezra Pound. Then we have the 5 sections, the burial of the dead, a game of chess, the fire sermon, death by water, and what the thunder said. Now let's look into these sections very, very briefly to just get the crux of what he's trying to say in each section and why 5 sections. Now the burial of the dead. See, we have two important symbols in the title itself. The burial and the dead. So it starts with death and burial. And then it goes on to say that death is there, burial is there, but there is no regeneration. There is no revival. There is no coming back. Now what is this coming back? That we are spiritually dead. And we do not want to come back alive from this death. We are morally dead, spiritually dead. So he established some of the core themes of the Wasteland in this section, death, burial, and rebirth. Then there is also a description of the impact of the First World War on the people and the cities of Europe. Now this title has been taken from the burial of the dead fertility and the burial service of the Christian church. Now let me look into the very first beginning lines of the text, the burial of the dead. And these lines say, April is the cruelest month, breeding lilacs out of the dead land, mixing memory and desire, stirring dull roots with spring rain. Now see April, each word is a symbol. It has implied meanings. Now this April goes back to Geoffrey Chaucer's mention of April as the best season of the spring season, with April with sweet showers. So April is supposed to be, it is considered to be the best and the most pleasant season in the year. But see, look at how Eliot starts his poem. April is the cruelest month. Why cruel? April is supposed to be spring. April is supposed to be regeneration, but it is cruel for us because we do not want to regenerate. We are spiritually dead and we are happy to be dead. So it starts with the very symbol that we are morally, spiritually dead and we do not want to come alive. So April is the cruelest month for people like us. For our lands which are dead, although lilac flowers are coming out of the lands, they are mixing memory and desire. Memory again a symbol of the past. Desire a symbol of the present and future. But the land is dead. Then again winter kept us warm. Winter again is a symbol of cold, of death, of loss of activity, loss of movement, loss of joy. So winter kept us warm, covering earth in forgetful snow, a little life with dead tubers. So this is how the Wasteland starts, with a pictorial description of, symbolic description of the modern Wasteland. Now in the next lines he comes to kind of story making. There is a character called Mary, who is a German princess, and she narrates her experiences. I went down with an archduke and cousin. Now, what does it denote? What is important here is not the character, not what she is doing. What is important is the spiritual degradation she is going through. Through the physical pleasures, the sexual desires, she is transporting herself from the world of innocence to the world of experience. And then she is portraying her nostalgia. Then there are biblical allusions. What are the roots that clutch branches grow out of this stony rubbish? Now it is stony also, it is rubbish also. Again, symbolic. There is no water, there is no soil, there is no humidity, there is no moisture, there is no positivity. It's stony, it's dry, it's hard to crack. Now this is the biblical allusion. As in the last line he mentions, only there is shadow under this red rock. Now rock is actually dry, colorless, but red rock means it is colored with the blood of Christ. So here there is a ray of hope that yes, the world can be saved by the faith in religion or Christ. Now a very important part, if you all remember, we've been doing in the class, is Madame Sosostris and her tarot cards. They play a very important role in the whole poem because her tarot cards are going to appear throughout the next sections. These tarot cards that she carries with her, and she is kind of counseling her customers with these tarot cards, these are going to become characters in the next sections of the poem. So she has the tarot cards, drowned Phoenician sailor, belladonna. Each card represents some attribute of humanity. There is hope for life. Belladonna is any beautiful lady, any lady of situations who take the situations to carry on with her pleasures and all that. Then we have the card of the man with three states, who is again a symbolic of these three attributes of human character: giving, sympathizing, and self-control. Then the card of the wheel of fortune. Then the one-eyed merchant. Now this merchant is going to be personified. This card is going to be personified as a merchant, Mr. Eugenides, in the next sections. Then there is the card of the hanged man, a very important implied symbol. Who is the hanged man? Christ. Now she says, look at what she says. She says, I can't find the hanged man. He's missing somewhere. Now that means for the modern man, there is no renewal, because he doesn't want the hanged man in his life. He doesn't want Christ. He doesn't want religion. He is happy without faith. In fact, he is not even happy, but he is living without the card of faith. Now the next important symbol and the reference that he gets into the text, the first section, is the unreal city. He calls London the unreal city. Now here, London doesn't mean he's just criticizing London. London here means any unreal city, any city of the look of a metropolitan, where you have crowds passing over the bridges and following an aimless wandering and a mechanical routine. So the last part of this section goes with a conversation of Tiresias with Stetson. Now who is Stetson? He is any person representing humanity from the ancient ages to the present modern times. Now what is important here is the symbol of the dog. Dog, he says, oh, keep the dog far hence, that's a friend to man. Or with his nails he will dig it again. Now what will the dog do? If you keep the dog close to you, he's going to dig into the soil again and make you reborn, revival of faith, because dog is a symbol of conscience, awareness, sincerity, friendliness. So this is how he goes on with the first section. Now you've seen we've had several fragments in this section. We've had several allusions that have been put together into one section, the burial of the dead, which simply shows that there is loss of faith in the present civilization. Coming to the second section, which is named A Game of Chess. Now we know this game. We need to play very smart in this game. And this is what exactly is shown in this section. It is a comment on relationships. This device has been used by Thomas Middleton in the Elizabethan play Women Beware Women, where this game of chess is used to hide the seduction of a young girl. So basically it talks about the lack of emotional bonding and the perversion of sex in the modern society. Now there are two scenes involving two kinds of women. Now the first kind of scene, the first scene that happens here, it starts with this. It is the chamber of a girl like Cleopatra. It's a highly groomed woman surrounded by lavish and exquisite furnishings and luxuries present in her room. She's a rich upper class lady. Now, but what is happening in her life? She's waiting for her lover. She's going crazy. She's mad. She's emotionally blank. And when the lover comes, they're not able to communicate with each other. They have no emotional understanding with each other. He comes and he leaves. And she is again paranoid. So this character is again, here the mention of the story of Philomela is very, very important. This allusion has been taken from Ovid's Metamorphoses. The Philomela, the girl who is raped by her brother-in-law who is a king, and then her tongue is cut so that she is not able to speak the truth. And then she goes and tells the truth to her sister in the form of an embroidered cloth. She writes a story to her sister, and the sister is angry. She kills her son. The sister kills her son, and she serves the flesh to her husband. So then eventually all that drama takes place, and these two girls are turned into birds, and Philomela is turned into a nightingale. So this is an allusion to this kind of a story. Now, the second part of the second section talks about the low middle class society. We don't have the lavish setup. It's the scene of a pub, East London pub. And these two ordinary ladies belonging to the working class are talking to each other. And Lil is the lady, and she's talking about, my husband is going to come and I'm not well. My body is shedding away and I'm shedding my teeth and all this and all that, sorrows and, you know, the mishappenings and the unpleasant things that had happened. Now, in the meantime, what is happening is there is a barmaid, the bartender, who is coming time and again to say, hurry up, please, it's time. Hurry up, please, it's time. I've mentioned this in the red text, that time and again this line will come, hurry up, please, it's time. So now this shows, this is again implied, indicative of the mechanical kind of a routine of the working class. No matter how sad they are, how shattered they are, still they go on with their sorrows and sharing. And towards the end of this part, the story, you know, what happens is, interestingly, this section ends with a line echoing Ophelia's suicide speech in Hamlet. She says, good night, good night, good night, time and again. She says, good night, and then she says, good night, good night, good night. Now, these are the words that were uttered by Ophelia, the heroine of the play Hamlet by Shakespeare. Now, this indicates something else again, that the ladies, the women in this kind of a working class are on the verge of suicide. They're not happy. They are disillusioned. They are disgusted because of the struggles of their life. Now, the third section, the fire sermon, is equally important. Now, because this title has been taken from the Buddha's sermon, in which he advocates to his followers that the earth is burning in a fire of lust. Let's get away from it. Let's rid ourselves from this fire. Now, this section again has a canvas of disparate fragments, disparate realities, disparate stories, a variety of stories put together, wherein he starts the section with a scene of a riverside, and then he puts in all these negative symbols like rats moving around. Now, this is a very negative symbol, rats and garbage, but then there is fishing also. Now, fishing is supposed to be a symbol of regeneration. So no matter how negative Eliot visions the world right now, but he has positive note inside his mind. He wants to set the world in order. He says, no matter how filthy the modern wasteland is now, but I still have, there is a chance of revival. I still have that positive note inside my mind that yes, the world is going to regenerate and come back. That is why fishing time and again, regeneration. So then again, there is a reference, there are lots of references in this section again, reference to Spencer's Prothalmium about sweet Thames River running softly. Then there is a mention of that character, the merchant, Mr. Eugenides, that was mentioned earlier in Madame Sosostri's tarot pack cards. Then the fire sermon proceeds to a very important section. Now, these lines from the view of the examination are also very important. If you all remember, we talked about this allusion of a typist girl, like a taxi. So let me read these lines. At the violet hour, when the eyes and back turn upward from the desk. Now, this is a girl, any girl who works in a company. She's a typist girl. She's working from morning to evening. When the human engine waits. Now, here it is called a human engine. This is how he creates a metaphor. Human engine waits like a taxi, throbbing, waiting. I, tiresious, though blind, throbbing between two lives. Old man with wrinkled female breasts can see at the violet hour. So who is the spectator here? Who is the narrator here? Tiresias. Tiresias is the spectator who is watching what is happening in this mechanical society. This girl, it can be any girl. She's a typist girl working from morning to evening at a desk, getting up, waiting for a taxi. Now, she's not actually waiting for a taxi. She has been compared to a taxi, as if anybody can come in, and she's throbbing and waiting. So this is a part of her life. This is a part of her personality now. And then when she comes back, Tiresias is watching with all. Now Tiresias is a prophet. He has seen the lives of both man and woman. We have read the story of Tiresias. Now he watches what is happening. She comes home, she arranges her home, and then it is the tea time, the breakfast time, and then she manages things, and then she waits for her lover. The lover comes mechanically, you know, they have a relation, he goes back, and he is an arrogant middle-class clerk, but then there is arrogance. And she is a very mechanical kind of a recipient who is just waiting for things to happen and pass. Then in the Fire Sermon, we have other allusions that refer to Spencer, that refer to St. Augustine, also referring to Queen Elizabeth's encounter with Earl of Leicester when she used to go around with him in the Thames River for a picnic ride. But he now says that now the Thames River is not as sweet, it is not as pleasant, it is not no more a picnic site for the people. Now the fourth section, which is the shortest, is death by water, but it is equally important because here, see, water symbolizes two things. Water symbolizes death as well as water symbolizes purification, regeneration. So here both the ideas are looked into. Now there's a character, Phlebas. Now this character again was mentioned in Madame Sosostre's tarot cards. What did she say? She says, fear death by water. This is how the Jyotishi log, they tell you. Isse dar ke rehna, isse bach ke rehna. So Madame Sosostris had told him, fear death by water. So this Phlebas, he just dies. He's drowned in water. He's drowned, he dies, and his body is nothing else but a product of decay. So it has a twofold layer of meaning. Firstly, the prophecy of Madame Sosostris. She said, fear death by water. Now he's drowning. Secondly, the language, the form in which this part is presented is difficult. It is like a parable. We used to have fables, biblical, and you know. So that kind of an imagery comes in this section. So in reality, whatever we look into the multiple layers of the section, in reality, the only lesson that needs to be incurred from this section is that the physical reality of death and decay, it wins over everything else. Whether he is a rich merchant, whether he is intelligent, whether he is successful, whether he is whatever. But death and decay is going to triumph and he is not resurrected. Means he is not reborn. Here are the details of this Phoenician sailor. We talked about it. Now, the last and the most quoted section of this poem is what the thunder said. Section 5, the final section, which is dramatic in both its imagery and its events. Now this starts with the reference to Christ. When Christ was arrested, there was a trial, the crucifixion. So the implied meaning is that Eliot wants to say that the modern man has killed Christ by his neglect, by his callous attitude, his indifference. Kind of, he doesn't want to bother about Christ. Now, Christ here means any religious value, faith in religious values or Christianity or maybe any other religious values. Now, then this section also covers the journey of Sir Parsifal in search of the Holy Grail when he walks with his followers to the Chapel Perilous. It's a far-off land. The journey is very tough. It is very fearful. It's monstrous. There are rocky mountains and there are monsters, you know, grappling out of the hills and mountains and rocks, and he covers this journey. Finally, eventually to reach there and go near the approach the Holy Grail, which is considered to be pious as well as mysterious. Now, it also refers to another journey of Christ's followers. Two followers are going to Emmaus. They are walking to Emmaus and they feel there is a third person walking near us. And that third person is hooded. His face is not visible and that is actually Christ. So their faith works here. So this is a kind of a juxtaposition. A parallel is drawn by Eliot to portray the faith in the olden days among the followers of Christ and the loss of faith today in the modern wasteland. Then, yes, there is a description of post-World War impacts on different parts of Europe. Now, coming to a very interesting part of the last section, the Indian wasteland. See, now he's covered all the wastelands, he's got his quotations and allusions from different cultures, but now he comes to the Indian wasteland. Now, these are lines 396 to 423. Now, they start off with a description of the Indian river Ganga. And it's an ancient Indian story when there was a famine in India. There was a drought. The land was dry, the jungles crouched. I'll read round the text for you. Ganga was sunken and the limp leaves waited for rain while the black clouds gathered far distant over Himavant. The jungle crouched, humped in silence. Then spoke the thunder. Da, da, da. Now what is he doing here? There was drought. It was dry everywhere. So people started praying. This is what happens in India. It's an old culture. We start praying, oh God, oh God, oh God, do something. So what happens is Prajapati talks to people in the form of thunder. In the form of thunder, he talks and there is a sound of da. Da. Now here da has been interpreted as three words. Da, datta, damyata, dayadhvam. See, now this reference has been taken from the Upanishads, Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, and he has quoted these words in Sanskrit itself in the text. So da, datta means to give something out of, you know, give a part of yourself to others, to society. Dayadhvam, compassion, to sympathize. Damyata, self-control. So these are the three advocates that he collects from the Eastern philosophy, Hindu philosophy, and tries to kind of put it here in his search for a true direction, in his search for order in society. Now the conclusion of the poem, it almost ends with what Prajapati says, Datta Damyata Dayadham. So what the thunder said concludes with a collage of quotations, not just in Sanskrit, but from various sources. Let's see, just a brief overview. There's a nursery rhyme, he says, London Bridge is falling down, and it's a poem in English. Now what is he doing here? Let me just summarize, what is he doing in the conclusion? He says, shall I at least set my lands in order? Now he says, I have seen the entire view, what the modern wasteland is like. I have juxtaposed also with the ancient lands, the ancient wastelands. But what is happening, I don't know. Shall I at least put my lands in order? Shall I at least put my mind in order? Shall I at least work for my peace? Let the others come behind me. So this is how he concludes the poem. This is the first time he creeps in, I. Here it is not Tiresias, it is the author himself, Eliot himself. Shall I at least set my lands in order? Let the world come behind. So here he is trying to enumerate all these quotations from different sources, from varied sources. There is a nursery rhyme, London Bridge is falling down. Then there is a quotation from Dante's Purgatorio. Then there is a quotation from a Latin poem. Then there is a quote from a Tennyson poem. Then there is a quote from a sonnet by Nerval. Then there is a line from Thomas Kidd's Elizabethan play, the Spanish tragedy, where he says, Hieronymus is mad again. And finally, he ends the poem with the word, Datta Dayadhvam Damyata Shantihi Shantihi Shantihi. Now, which Eliot says, now here he goes to, besides Hinduism, he also goes to Buddhism. Shantihi, which he says is peace which passeth understanding. It has been repeated thrice. Now, what do you mean by peace which passeth understanding? Means it is a kind of a peace. Shanti is a peace which you cannot just understand. You have to experience it. Which you cannot just talk about or write about. You have to go through it. So this is the kind of equivalent to the Buddhist concept of Nirvana or the Hindu moksha. So this is how he concludes his poem, that at least I am trying to get order into my mind and my life. Let others follow. So this is how he goes with his textual flow. Now, coming to the major issue of examinations, how do we prepare? As students, how do we prepare this particular poem for examinations? So what I suggest is three main topics need to be covered for examinations. The first and the foremost important topic is the theme. What is the underlying theme in the poem, or what are the thematic concerns that we find pervaded in the whole poem? Number two, the imagery, the symbolism and the mythological allusions. And number three, the form and structure, which is no doubt it is complex and incomprehensible in one read. You have to read and reread the text again and again to get to the gist of the poem. So let's discuss. We have a number of themes. We've already seen these themes, how he, in each section, he covers these themes repeatedly through different stories. He's talking of loss of spiritual and moral values. He's talking of the loss of religious faith, where he says it's all dry land, there is no water, there is no flowers, no vegetation. Then there is rebirth and regeneration. The very first line of the poem starts with it. Then there is a shallow relationships and lack of understanding. The section, A Game of Chess, is completely devoted to this theme. Lil, her husband, and Cleopatra, all these are coming under this theme. Then stress and nervous breakdown. Most of the people, most of the characters he is portraying in this, they are stressed out. And they are on the verge of nervous breakdown. That is why he gets Ophelia's speech and allusions from the past. Then there is politics and violence. Yes, of course, post-World War scenarios come again and again. Then there is a talk about sexual perversion and lust. There is commercialization of human life. There is the mechanical life routine, lack of communication, and finally, his own search for direction. So these are the themes that are broadly covered in the play. See, it is more comprehensive than we can see. Look at it in 1 hour. Now, the next very important topic that we need to be thorough with while we are preparing for examinations is symbolism. We have innumerable symbols in the text. These are just a few examples. You can collect symbols of your choice also. For example, London. London is any unreal city, any crowded city, any metropolitan city where life is hectic, where life is disorderly. It is mechanical. Then winter symbolizes death, spring, rebirth, drought, spiritual barrenness, rocks, spiritual barrenness. Dog is a positive symbol, symbol of human conscience. Fishing, spiritual rebirth and regeneration. Fire, lust as well as purification. Fire and water stand for both positive and negative. Death, destruction as well as purification. Rats alley. We are in a rat's race. We say that often. We are in a rat race. So he's mentioning. He says we are all in a rat's alley. You know, trying to run after each other all the time. Then the important symbol, taxi throbbing and waiting. Thames River, London Bridge, Typist Girl, German Princess, Jug story of Philomela. Yes, coming to a very complex part of the poem, the form and structure. Let's first talk about the form. See, the form is like a canvas. It's a big canvas, huge canvas, and there are lots of, things gone into it. Lots of planning has gone into it. So these are basically the kinds of strategies used, the kinds of methods used to make this form as such. Let me take each form. Mythical method. We know mythology has been taken up. Now, what is this mythical method? It is planned as a mythical method. Mythical method is taken to give you the experience in a symbolic form. He may also say there is a lot of filth around Thames River. You won't like it. We know it. But he's getting Queen Elizabeth moving around with Earl of Leicester in the Elizabethan age, and look at it now. There are sandwich wrappers and all that stuff. So he is kind of juxtaposing. Now for Eliot had a theory that poetry has gone very mundane, very ordinary, very normal, very simple, very boring, very dull. So this was a kind of a method to revitalize poetry through this mythical method. Then in the mythical method, Tiresias is a very important unifying link in the poem. If we don't have Tiresias, we do not know who is speaking, who is watching, who is doing what. So he is unifying. Now then again, it is a parallel between contemporariness and antiquity. Antiquity means the old times, the modern times and the old times. The mythical method is kind of unifying them. Then the collage. We know what is a collage? It's a huge canvas where bits and pieces of different kinds are, you know, put together to make a complete picture of something which implies something. So what is the collage doing here? Two or more different, disparate realities coming together. Not everything is same. Everything is different here. Lots of things happening in the wasteland. Then a new kind of relationship is made in the collage. Low culture, high culture. Then they are again parallel. And the end result, when you see a collage on violence, the end result will be discomfort. You'll be very uncomfortable in your mind. There is discomfort, there is paradox, and there is enigma. Right? Then there is the method of alchemy. You've heard this word alchemy? A mixture of metals put together to form a new something. So alchemy here, how does it work? See the second point. When reading a book on alchemy, the reader must read over the words to figure out the way to follow, decoding the secret. The word here is decoding. What he is writing, what words he is giving are not actually the words he wants you to understand. He wants you to decode the words. This is alchemy, right? Then the labyrinth. Now, what is a labyrinth? Have you been to a bhulbhulaya somewhere? We walk straight, rasta band, we come back. We walk to the other direction, rasta band, we come back. We walk in another third direction, we don't find the way, we come back. So we keep looking for ways. Have you seen that? Bhulbhulaya maze, that is the labyrinth. This is what exactly is happening in the wasteland, which makes it a difficult text. We go to find, hum sochte hain ki abhi chal rahe ye theme hai, nahi 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 nahi, ye theme nahi hai, wapis aa jaiye. Then we look for another theme. Fir hum sochte hain ye style hai iska, nahi 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 nahi, wapis aa jaiye. We look for another style with what Eliot is writing. So it works as, it goes as a labyrinth. Then there is a kaleidoscopic view. Kaleidoscope dekhte hain, uske andar bahut sare mirrors lage hote hain. Ek hi vision hoti hai, wo reflect bhi hoti, refract bhi hoti, and there is a multiple image formation. This is how Eliot's poem works. Then there is the film technique, which is technically called the montage technique. Images put together, reel bana di, usko edit kar diya, reel bana ke, aur wo images chalti rehti hai. You have to look at those images in a series. Something is happening continuously like a film. That is the form. Now the structure, a very important question that we often have in the examinations. What is the structure of the wasteland? Is it circular? Is it linear? Is it progressive? What is it? It is divided into five sections, but still. So there is a lot of debate over this question. Most of the critics have something to say of their own. But then what we can agree to is, Helen Gardner writes here, we're not, however, moving in a circle, but on a spiral. Now, you see this plant? Spiral. This plant is like a spiral. It is not, it is circular also, but it is moving somewhere also. It is spiraling down. So it is progressive also. So spiral is actually, in each section, each symbol, image, the theme repeats itself. So there is repetition also, but it is, see, it is moving from a problem to a solution also. Towards the end of the poem, he comes to the solution also. Now coming to the examinations. What all do we have to face in the examinations? We've discussed three topics in the wasteland. Number one is the thematic concerns. Number two is the images, symbols and allusions. And number three, we have the form and structure of the poem. Now whatever questions we get in the examinations are generally indirect questions. Oblique questions. They're not straight questions, evaluate the theme of wasteland. Or they will not ask you, give the structure of the wasteland. Normally the questions would be oblique. For example, how far is the wasteland an expression of the disillusionment of post-war generation? So what do we have to write in this? Theme? Thematic concerns? Post-war generation has the thematic concerns. How far is it correct to say that the wasteland is a vision of desolation and spiritual drought? What do we write in this? Theme again. spiritual drought, desolation, disgust, disillusionment, degeneration, denigration, all these are themes of the poem. The Wasteland is still the most influential poem of our age. Nothing else so truly reflects the age and redeems it. Again, the theme, the importance of the poem. Why is the poem still influential? Because of its thematic concerns also and the style also. So a bit of the style also has to be inserted. Because of his excessive use of symbols, implied imagery and allusions, this poem is still influential even after almost 100 years of its publication. It was published in 1922. The next question, myth serves as an organizing principle in the structure of the Wasteland. Do you agree? Now, what do we do with this question? Which topic? The structure also and the myth also. So we cover both the topics, the myths in brief and the structure also. Explain and analyze the imagery used to portray modern life. Now, what is this question about? Explain and analyze the imagery. It's about the imagery. So what topic do you have to cover in this? The topic of the symbols, the imagery, the allusions, the implied meanings in this. Then do you agree with the statement, the structure of the Wasteland is not progressive but circular? Now what is expected in this question? You have to write about the structure. Justify. Now, broadly speaking, any question that appears in the examination has concern with the three topics. Theme, imagery and symbolism, structure. If we are thorough with three topics of the Wasteland, I am sure that we will be able to deal with any oblique or indirect question or implied question that appears in the examination. Right? For reference, yes, you can take up any reference book of your choice. And thank you for listening to me. I invite questions from the students. टेक्स्ट में बहुत सारे सिंबल्स इमेजेस और अल्यूजन्स है एग्जाम में कितने अटेम्प्ट करें थैंक यू देखिए टेक्स्ट में एलियट हैज यूज्ड एज मेनी एज 60 रेफरेंसेस फ्रॉम 40 डिफरेंट ऑथर्स सो डेफिनेटली इट इज नॉट पॉसिबल टू पिक अप एवरी अल्यूजन दैट ही हैज यूज्ड बिकॉज द टेक्स्ट इज रिच इन इट्स इमेजरी So we have to select the symbols and images of our choice and which we best understand, which best represent that section to put it in our answer. Maybe for one section you pick up 2 to 3 or 6 images and then you can quote those images from the original text. Maybe you can pick up just one image from the section Death by Water. You can just pick up one image of water. So not necessarily, आपको सारी images नहीं लेनी है, because it is a complex work, जिसमें बहुत ज्यादा variety of images है. 60 works को Eliot ने यहाँ पे quote किया है, हम उसको एक question में quote नहीं कर सकते. तो आपको वो images लेनी है, जो आपकी समझ में बहुत ज्यादा अच्छी तरह से आती है. और जिनको आप अच्छे से explain कर सकते हैं, और जो आपके answer को justify करती है. तो मान लीजिए आप बड़ा बिग सेक्शन है तो उसमें से आप 4 to 8 इमेजेस लेके उनको एक्सप्लोर कर सकते हैं और स्मॉल सेक्शन है डेथ बाय वाटर है तो जस्ट वन इमेज ऑफ वाटर इज सफिशिएंट फॉर दैट राइट सिमिलरली द माइथोलॉजिकल एल्यूजन्स और द स्टोरीज ऑफ फिलोमेला एंड हाइसन गर्ल यू मे नॉट अंडरस्टैंड द स्टोरी ऑफ द जर्मन ओपेरा और द हाइसन गर्ल तो आप उसको छोड़ सकते हैं हो सकता है आपको स्टोरी ऑफ फिलोमेला ज्यादा अच्छे से समझ आए आप उसको ले सकते हैं सो इट इज योर लेवल ऑफ अंडरस्टैंडिंग योर टेस्ट व्हाट यू वांट टू पर आप सारी इमेजेस नहीं लें बिकॉज इट बिकम्स वेरी कॉम्प्लेक्स एज एन आंसर एनी मोर क्वेश्चंस यस 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 क्या हम अपने व्यूज दे सकते हैं रिगार्डिंग द फॉर्म एंड स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ द पोएम, क्योंकि क्रिटिक्स ने बहुत ज्यादा डिफरेंट व्यूज जो है वो लिखे हैं, तो बिल्कुल दे सकते हैं. लाइक वी गो बैक टू द स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ द पोएम. यस, सी द स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ द पोएम कैन बी सर्क्यूलर, इट कैन बी लीनियर, इट कैन बी प्लेन, इट कैन बी फ्लैट, इट कैन बी प्रोग्रेसिव, बट हियर वी आर कॉलिंग इट स्पाइरल. तो आपका व्यू अगर ऐसा है, जैसे यहां पे एक क्वेश्चन आया था, do you agree with the statement the structure of the wasteland is not progressive but circular? तो अब progressive नहीं है, circular है, जरूरी नहीं है आप इससे इसी से ही agree करेंगे. आप कह सकते हैं कि it is progressive. आप ऐसा भी कह सकते हैं कि it is circular. Circular का मतलब क्या होता है कि जहां से बात शुरू हुई थी वहीं पे खत्म हो रही है. If you think he is not going anywhere, he is not reaching anywhere, जहां से उसने problem start की थी वहीं आके उसने खत्म कर दिया, तो आप कह सकते हैं circular. But you will have to justify your answer. आपको ये बताना पड़ेगा illustrations के साथ. You will have to illustrate your answer, give all the facts and logic behind it. Why is it circular? Circle means it started with a point and it has come back and joined the same point. Linear means it is walking in a straight line. It is not straight, of course we know it. It's too complex, too zigzag. Then progressive means it is progressing to a certain solution. That is why, see, most of the critics have come down to a solution that it is spiral. There is a circular motion also because he is coming back to the same thing again and again. He is coming back to loss of moral values, lust and sex perversion and, you know, all these stuffs of the society is coming back to circle, moving in a circle, but he is also progressing somewhere. So by the end of the poem, he is kind of reached a point where he is setting his own lands in order. That means he has reached a point where his goal of attaining shanti, 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 whether we talk it in terms of Buddhist nirvana or Hindu moksha, he is kind of reaching there. So we can't say that he just stopped at a particular place and the circle where it started has ended. So he is moving also. Yes, you can give your own views, but you will have to justify what you are saying. If I am saying it is linear, I have to tell how it is linear. If I say it is circular, you have to tell how. You may not agree with Eliot. He has presented a document as a picture of society. And that is why in the end, he leaves you free. He says, shall I set my lands in order? So in the last part of the section, he is initiating the thing with himself. So you may agree with him, you may not agree with him. But yes, you can write your own opinions at the examinations, provided you are clear with the justification of the statement. Any more questions? Thank you for being with me. Thank you so much.